Where would you know what he said about women? Can I just confirm something?
He is a pure, innocent man. Is this man, Muhammad, obviously running around having sex all day with this woman?
I just want to confirm something.
And he was bewitched. Do you know that he was bewitched?
Can we just one subject at a time? Because I'm not someone who can multitask like a woman, right? I'm not a woman.
So, a prophet.
When you say he never said anything, when you say he never said anything good about women, do you know his statements? How many hundreds of statements we have from him? So when you say he never said anything good about women,
that's what you hear.
What have you read? Have you read whole of Bukhari, a collection of his sayings, whole of Muslim? The reason I'm trying to understand your approach. I can understand you have many questions, right? I can understand you have many questions. I can understand you have many questions, right? So let's deal with one thing at a time. Your knowledge about what Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said about women, you said he never said anything good about women.
No.
So is your knowledge about
6 years old?
If you allow me to understand your position, there are many things he said about women which are narrated in the books of hadith, for example, like in Bukhari and Muslim and Sunan, Abu Dawood and Tirmidhi and Nasai, Ibn Majah, Ahmed bin Hanbal's Musnad, in Mu'attab, Imam Malik, in Abi Shaiba, his Musannaf, in Abdul Razak, Musannaf. There are hundreds and thousands of narrations. And to say that you have never, he didn't say anything good, never, about women, means...
Sorry if I say never. What I'm saying is that from the stuff that I watched,
right.
I read it about women, and that was shocking.
Sure. How did you read? Did you read selectively from... by taking a non-Muslim website like an atheist or a Christian, or did you go to the Muslim sources like say Bukhari? Sahih Bukhari is a can I finish? I want to know the approaches you've taken. Say you have this book, right? In fact, there are books written by Muslims about women, the status of women in Islam. Did you read any of those books? Right. So maybe, I mean, without explaining anything, take an opportunity to read a book on the status of women in Islam, which summarizes everything what Islam has to say, Prophet Muhammad has to say, or the Quran has to say about women. So you can get an overview. Because to say that he hasn't said good thing about women means you have studied all of these things. That's what I say is, when you take things out of contextual understanding, it will be seen like he's saying woman is a devil.
The man explained it in Arabic and in English.
Do you know what?
And then I check, and then here I am, I write everything.
Yeah.
And that's really shocking. It's not only that. Muhammad was struggling, he was killing himself, he was bewitched, he was saying things that he thinking he did.
So now I realize,
Muslim believed.
In fact, what I realize is from the questions, from the things you're bringing up, remember, I have been coming here from the 90s, right? Late 90s. This is not the first time I've heard these criticisms against the Prophet. And I seem to know roughly where they come from, right? Wait. And the basis of these criticisms is such that when the same criticisms are answered by Muslims in the form of books, lectures, YouTube videos, or articles in the web, unfortunately, the critics who raise these objections, they are selective in what they read. They don't read a response. For example, if you ask me, if I have a question, an objection to a Christian teaching, do you know what I would do? Do you know what I do? I would go to find out how do the Christian academics answer the objections. Perhaps I'll go to their commentaries. I will go to, say, Tectonic website, a few other websites where I know they produce quality material, and I will see what is their response. If I find the response is quite objection, then I will say this criticism and objection is actually justifiable. It's an objection that is easily answered. But unfortunately, for many objections to Islam or about on Prophet Muhammad's character, even though the responses are provided, the critics do not go and read and study those responses.
But you know, my brother, can I say something? I agree that people do rape children, and even in my country, everywhere, anywhere, that's fine. I'm not saying Muhammad is the first person who done that. But I wanted to know, if he's my leader, if he's the one that I look up to, if he's going to be my real good model, if I see Muhammad as my real good model, I need to see good examples. I need to see good things in him so that I can follow. Like Jesus.
Absolutely. We agree with you.
Otherwise, in my country,
so,
I
let me.
Africa, men,
I, we are in agreement. We are in agreement.
Yeah.
To take someone as a role model, we have to show from the life of that individual how the individual behaved, how the individual taught someone through the actions and statements. So if I were to give you some examples, he said, the best of you, men, are the ones who's best with your woman. What would you understand by that statement? No, of course you haven't. That's precisely my point. But now I'm telling you one by one, little by little, but I'll leave you to study in depth yourself. It's better for your own reflection. So when the Prophet said, the best among you is the one who treats his woman the best. So it's not that you're best because you have more money. This, but the one who treats the woman the best. He said,
if you ask the man to be their wife.
One moment. Let us understand one case by case. So when he said, the best of you is the one who's best to your wives. Do you think this teaching is a good teaching that we should all follow?
I would say yes, what you just said now, but what I'm saying is, say this brother, for example, he gave some people to charity and then he did something good in his life, yeah? But one day he killed someone. So we have to speak about both, isn't it? We can say, yes, he's a good man, he did this, he did that, but oh, he also killed someone.
Sure.
He also did something evil.
You have to take the whole life. You have to tell the whole life and actions.
Well, that's the fact, isn't it? It's in your Quran.
Look, we agree with you that to take someone as an example, you have to take the whole life and actions of that individual. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, did he kill anyone individually?
He did.
Who?
He did. There's a woman that she was riding his camel. Mm-hmm. He cut her hand off.
He chopped himself?
No, himself. He ordered it.
Right. So now, you are saying he ordered someone to be killed or, you know, get punished, whatever. Did he kill himself, anyone?
I didn't read the whole.
That's important for you to read,
yeah,
right?
Remember, it doesn't matter if he's a leader and if he's telling people to do it.
Right.
The same.
The examples that you're giving. Let me share with you some thoughts on this. There are many criticisms on the actions of the Prophet, which were the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Apparently, he got killed a blind man or a poet woman, things like this. If you were to understand how the Muslims see it, you'll see the reports about these stories, the ones specifically that people criticize the Prophet of, are very weak, if not rejectable, right? Some of them may be fabricated, some of them may be very weak reports. We have what we call authenticating what the Prophet said. For example, I cannot come on and say, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said this, that. I could just be making this up. How do I know what the Prophet said? So we have a whole science to establish the authenticity of the Prophet's statements and his actions. And please just to bear with me. So this is the called science of hadith, in which we establish. So he said, this gentleman said, Imagine within the first 300-400 years, to make it simple. He said, I heard the Prophet said that. I would like to know, where did you get this from? Because you did not see the Prophet yourself. You live, say, about 200 years after. He said, I heard from my teacher. Yep. He passed on through this memorization. He memorized that statement. And he heard from his teacher. And his teacher was the companion of the Prophet who heard from the Prophet, right? Now, we would need to know, within these people who are transmitting it, okay, you are telling me, are you an honest person? Do you have good memory of what your teacher taught you? Are you an honest individual? A truthful person, that you don't lie and you don't deceive? So we will do a character check. We have to establish that he is also a man of good character. Depending on how his character is, even if the Prophet said, for example, the Prophet said, the best of you is the best with your woman. But if we find in the chain of transmission, one of the person, not you, say a person here, who is, but I can't say, because what I'm saying is a bad thing, right? A person here who is known by the community to lie, to deceive, to be dishonest. We would say, no, the Prophet didn't say that from that chain of narration. This is something will be rejected, that statement of the Prophet. The contents, the words that he said, can be established through other chains of trustworthy narrators. But that particular chain of narrations which has an individual who is a liar, we will reject it. So this is how we establish what the Prophet said or not. So when we examine the stories of these things, or he got someone killed, or someone, you know, tortured, this comes from narrations of people who are not reliable. No, this is not in the Quran. What is in the Quran? The statement, let me tell you something, one moment, let me wonder. In the Quran, there is not a single statement of the Prophet. We believe the Quran is a speech of God. Just like the Ten Commandments that God wrote with his own hands, it's not the speech of Moses, peace be upon him. Not even a dot, because according to your tradition, God wrote and inscribed on the tablets himself. Likewise, we believe the Quran is 100% verbatim word of God.
But then the problem, my brother, the problem is that Gabriel angel appeared 4 times in our Bible. One time he came for Daniel chapter 8, okay. He came to Daniel chapter 9, he came to Zacharias, John's father, to tell him he's going to have a son. The last time he came was his Mary. He told Mary he's going to have a son, and he would be called the Son of God. He would be the Savior of the world. So even that, the reason we believe in Isaiah in Old Testament, and it's already predicted, it's already prophesied that each child will be born from a virgin mother, which is now fulfilled in the New Testament. This is what Muslims don't understand.
So, I see, I don't have a problem with your particular approach and belief.
What I'm saying is that, my brother, I've been listening to you. What I'm saying is that for me, the reason I've been even studying, I want to see if Allah and God is the same, the God of Christ, and the Greek
right.
Allah. I was wondering, I said, I need to know. Right. I was Muslim. Yeah. I love Muslim, our friends, neighbors, I literally love you guys so much. But for me, I want to know.
Fine. How we so I'm giving you some tips.
So now, this Gabriel angel came forth, but Muhammad,
he is the angel of revelation.
Yes, okay. So how can, for me, I'm really, my big question is that, how can Gabriel angel tell Muhammad different, tell Mary she's going to have a son, will be the savior of the world, son of God? How can
very good.
So this is,
so let me,
so explain to me.
So let me try to help you understand how
Gabriel angel is alive. I cannot say that.
It's a very, very important question you've asked. It's a very good question. This is where we need to step outside the box and to analyze things as objectively as possible, you and I. When we try to understand the truthfulness and the veracity of a religious scripture and the teaching, we have to step a little bit outside and say, okay, fine. Without my preconceived belief and bias of my faith, how do I objectively analyze the truth of a scripture from God or not, right? In the case of the Quran, we have a criteria. Just briefly, before I go into this, right? So at least you know what this criteria is. The Quran is such that, the Quran itself says, it cannot be produced by anything other than God. Even if the jinns or another creation or the human beings came together. Jinn, like Satan is a jinn. Gabriel is an angel, right? So even if the jinns and the human beings came together, the Quran says, they will not be able to produce like the Quran. And the Quran challenges the people, if you're in doubt as to what God has sent to his slave, his servant Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then produce a chapter or a surah like unto this. And if you're truthful, but if you cannot do it, and the Quran affirms you will never be able to do it, then fear the fire whose fuel is man and stones. So the Quran gives a criteria here, what we call criteria, a test of falsification. It's a falsification test. If someone thinks the Quran is not from God, the simple thing to do is imitate a chapter or 10 or the whole book like the Quran, in the way the Quran is in its structure, in its genre, right? Of course, in the Arabic language. If you're unable to do that because you don't know Arabic, for example, the Quran says you can seek helpers and supporters besides God.
They're translated though in English.
No, what I'm saying is to match the Quran in the Arabic, if you don't speak or know Arabic language, the Quran doesn't simply make you like incapacitated there. It says, look, you can go to your helpers and supporters to do that for you who know Arabic. Like you can go to SOAS or Cambridge and Oxford and Harvard, wherever, where non-Muslim professors of Arabic language may be able to help you, right? The fact that the Quran has remained unimitated for 1400 years, it speaks volumes. But that's not what we are arguing now. The Quran also gives other falsification tests. One of them is, if people think it's not from God, then surely there'll be many discrepancies, errors and contradictions within the same book. And this is what we expect, logically speaking. If a book is from God, it is from the God. There would not be any mistakes within it, either mistakes of history or mistakes of prophecy, or mistakes within the science of this reality, right? It should not contradict itself, because God in his knowledge knows what he's speaking. Human beings may forget what they have said something, and 20 years later they might have forgotten. So a book written for 23 years, if it's not from God, you would expect this kind of contradictions. This is what the Quran says. If it's not from God, surely you'll find contradictions, right? So this is the criteria of falsification test the Quran provides. When you go to the Bible, which describes the angel Gabriel came 4 times, and so on, objectively speaking, we should ask similar type of questions. How do we know these written works, which comprises now the Bible or collection of books, not one book, many books? Depends on which church you follow. It could be 63, 70, something.
I don't follow church.
No. What I mean, the canon, the Protestant canon and the Catholic canon.
Brother, do you know my point again?
No, can I just make very quickly, I will just come back to this point. The holiness or the acceptability of a canon of the scripture is different in the Egyptian Coptics with Ethiopian Church, the Protestants and the Roman Catholic. The number of books are different in terms of...
Shall I answer it for that?
Yeah.
It's one. What happened is that Catholic, they believe... You understand? They have tradition that they follow. from a long time ago, so they don't want to come out from that. Even though they believe in Jesus, he's the Son of God, he died on the cross, but they still worship Mary, they still worship the saint, they still do things they're not supposed to do. If he died, for example, today, they still pray for you so that God will forgive you. No, when he dies, it's finished, it's too late. You're going to face God. So, yes, it is not the Bible is changed, it is the people how they interpret it, how they use it, and they use it for their own good. Some Christians today use the Bible to make rich himself, to make money out of it. You know that there's many places say Jesus they preach from here, but they're very millionaires. You understand? Yeah. That's not the way it is. He didn't tell us this. Jesus never charged anyone that he healed. Everything he did, Jesus never charged nobody else. So I'm not saying what happening today is right. And I'm sure that in Muslim the same thing. There is a lot of your scholars that find a lot of holes, a lot of stuff in the Quran. I watch it. I don't know if that's right.
It's just a propaganda. They don't even know what they're talking about.
So my point is, if the God of the Bible, the God of the Quran, I just want to know, are they same or not? And
sure.
I said to myself,
I like your approach. Your approach is fair. Your approach is fair and sensible.
Are we serving the same God?
As I said, I approach you. I very much honor and approach you. Your approach. It is fair. It is fair and sensible. Do we have the same God or not? Right. Right. To establish. Yeah, I agree with you. We have a lot of things. Lot of things in agreement. So to understand whether this Bible, not the church, indeed is from God, unadulterated, unchanged, pristine and clear, we need to establish that this is the case first. So when you examine the book, I mean, I'm not going to, as I mentioned, the differences between these different churches, forget that. The Bible that you, for the sake of argument, the Bible that you hold to be true, yeah, the words of God, how do we establish the authenticity and the veracity of this? Now, the first thing you will have to come in mind, okay, these are written by, either by God himself, revealed these texts in the original languages in Greek or Hebrew, or he inspired men. So when he inspired men, the people who wrote them and the people who collected these books, you do know that there are many gospels other than the four gospels written. Okay. I know personally about 49 gospels that is extant today. Some of them, in fact, all the bits and pieces that are available today have been published.
Men can do that.
No, I just want to make a point that
have a new Bible, for example.
I'm talking about gospels.
Yes.
The Gospel of Mark, Matthew, Luke, and John is what you have in your Bible, right? But there are other people who wrote gospels. For example, Gospel of Mary, which is not there. Gospel of not Catholic. Not, there is no Gospel of Mary within the Catholic.
They have. But it's a different book, brother. I can bring you and show it.
Okay. Gospel of the Ebionites?
Yes.
Gospel of St. Thomas?
Orthodox.
But Gospel of St. Thomas and the Ebionites are not in the Catholic Bible. So these are Gospels which were written not by Muslims, by people who call themselves Christians. But they did not end up within the Bible. My point is quite simple. People were writing the books with their own hands, claiming to be inspired or otherwise, and saying, this is from God. This is from God. Some of them, there, maybe you have a specific criteria how you have made these four as authentic. Point is, when you look at these four, when you examine them, do you know the authors who wrote them? They had good memory, they were honest, and they were truthful, and they did not lie. Because I am sorry to share with you, and I apologize in advance. Don't get offended. When I examine the Gospel of Matthew, the first Gospel, I see the author, whoever he is dishonest. He's twisting and fabricating history.
Matthew.
He is inventing prophecies. and he's changing the reality of history to for, right. Shall I give you some examples without being offended? Okay. Can I show you in your Bible?
Yes. When you say Matthew, where?
Yeah. Very beginning. Very beginning. We don't have to go far, okay? The first page, the very beginning. I'll give you maybe three examples will suffice, right? No more than three. Just three should be enough.
No, you said this is twisted.
No, not this. I'm saying when we examine Matthew, we will find examples to demonstrate.
But no, you're not answering my question.
Which is?
Nobody can do that. But remember what I was saying to you earlier. Gabriel angel came.
We can come to that point.
But you need to show me that.
No. Firstly, if you say Gabriel angel is from this book, quoted in this book, right? But if I now question the very authenticity that this book is from God, maybe you're not following.
No, I'll show you.
I am not doubting that there are these references, right? Okay. What I'm saying is,
you need to talk to me.
I understood. My approach is to take.
We're not talking about Matthew.
No. Let me tell you something. To take this as gospel truth, excuse my pun, right? To take this as gospel truth, in fact, from God, we have to establish that first. If I said the Quran says Jesus is a prophet of God, not God, would you just simply accept it? Would you?
I wouldn't.
Right. Likewise, to believe, for me to believe this is from God, I have to establish that first.
So definitely, this is from God.
That's your belief.
But Muhammad didn't tell you. Muhammad was the angel Gabriel. That's what I want you to explain,
look,
brother.
I understand what you're saying.
Angel lying.
I am saying what Gabriel has done here, the statements of Gabriel.
So is it Gabriel wrong or the people writing wrong?
The people who say things about Gabriel
is wrong.
I am questioning them.
That is right.
No, listen, please listen. I am questioning that the information about Gabriel in here is questionable. I'm going to give you my reasons now. That's what I'm trying to do. So please do not get offended. Forgive me if you are.
No.
Now I'll tell you now, very briefly. There is an individual who's writing this information for you, right?
No, Matthew wrote this one.
Okay.
Matthew.
Fine, Matthew. Matthew says something here.
This is the disciple Jesus chose first.
Whatever you believe. The information that he gives here, in here, is incorrect and false.
How?
Exactly, I'll tell you. So he says, he gives you that this is the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David,
yes,
and gives you the names.
Yeah.
A genealogy.
Yeah.
He says, so all the generations from Abraham to David. He says 14.
Yeah.
From David to the exiled to Babylon.
Yeah. This is just generation people.
One moment. You will see my point in a bit. Does he say some generations or all the generations?
All generations. Yeah.
All generations from Abraham to David are 14. How many?
14.
From David until the captivity in Babylon are 14. From the captivity in Babylon to Christ are 14. This is false and untrue, because we can go in the Old Testament to find these people,
yeah,
and we can.
Does it matter? Really?
No.
You're just telling the generation.
If someone, allow me to make my point.
Yeah, but I want you to tell me.
But allow me to make my point. This individual who's giving you this information,
yes,
Matthew.
I don't even know all of them.
He is dishonest. Okay, I'm going to show the dishonesty. I'm going to show that. Why don't you allow me to show that?
No, I don't need to see this. I'm not interested.
No.
I'm not interested.
I am saying.
You missed
my point.
No.
He is giving you statements from history.
This is about descendants. I'm not interested.
Wait. It's not about descendants.
I'm interested. You know what, brother, I'm interested?
You missed my point.
No.
You're now trying to... No, one second.
Brother.
One moment.
It's your Bible.
One moment.
It's your Bible.
Do you know why I'm asking you a question?
I'm asking about Gabriel.
To understand what Gabriel said,
you can ask him.
But what I'm saying is to...
The Christians in Eritrea and Christians in UK, for example, when you compare them, it's different.
It's not different. It's just that in Eritrea, we never read the Bible. The Bible has to be nicely placed somewhere, put candy around it. Don't touch it. You're not supposed to touch it. You're supposed to push it.
What about the people that go to church? What do they do?
You know those people, what's it called? Old Tigrinya. We call it, what's it in Tigrinya?
Which one? Amharic?
No.
Aramaic?
Gez.
That's it. So Gez, because it's Gez, it's very hard. It's not plain Tigrinya. We speak Tigrinya. So because of that, people go to church, they close their mouth, all the women cover themselves, nothing, you don't hear nothing. And the priest, they speak in Gez, and then they more than sing anyone, more than talking. They don't even teach. I grew up there asking them questions over and over. Me, myself, I've been told, no, your child, you're not supposed to ask a question. Can you imagine? Now, when I came in London, so when I read the Bible, I had a question to my son. I said, is the God of Islam the God of Islam?
Do you believe it's the same?
No. I said, we always believe the same. But when I read the Bible, I said,
did you read it in Tigrinya or in English? When you read the English, the translation, for example, is different to the Hebrew
or the Greek. It's not different, it's just that it doesn't explain in Tigrinya that much, but in English it explains more. The point is still not changing. If he says in Tigrinya, Jesus wants to understand the Hebrew now, in English, it says in English, Jesus got on the cross. There's not really different in Tigrinya. The point is still the same. It might slightly be different the way you said it and stuff, but in Tigrinya doesn't explain much. It's very short. But in English, it gives you a lot of meaning. So my question was, is that always, I was telling this brother, is that, I wanted to know, is Islam and then the God of the Bible are the same? The Quran and the Bible are the same. So why didn't you study Master? So how do you know the Quran? So I studied it. In fact, I keep a notes a lot here. I was showing to you, didn't I? So what I did was basically, who talking to Muhammad? So Gabriel Angel. And I said, who's this Gabriel Angel? I need to check in the Bible. Gabriel Angel, he came to chapter 9, chapter 8, Daniel. He came to show that he came to talk to Daniel from God. And then he came chapter 9 as well, twice. The third time he came in Zacharias to tell him that John is going to be born because they were very old. Zacharias didn't even believe. So the fourth time he came was to talk to Mary. So when he came to talk to Mary, he said to Mary, highly favored, rejoice, the Lord God is with you, so you're going to conceive a son. And she was really disturbed by, you know, how he said hello. She said, how can I have this because I'm only a virgin? He said, Elizabeth, your auntie, is in the 6 months, so there is nothing impossible with that. So the Holy Spirit will shadow you. And the Quran says the same. The Spirit will breathe underneath her skirt. That's what it says in the Quran. But in the Bible, it says that the Holy Spirit will shadow you, and then you will be considered a child. So the Quran says that Allah gave Mary the word. The word in the Quran says always that at the last day I will speak to you, I'll send you the word. So this word in the Quran is Jesus Christ. That's what he said to Mary.
Do you know in the Quran when it says the word, what that word is?
It's
In the Quran it explains it. It says kun fayakun. Be and it is. That's all God has to say.
Yes, but
be and it will be.
Of course. But my
that's what the Quran says, the word.
It's the word.
That's what it means. But you guys take it different. As the word became flesh, that's what you do.
Yes. Which is because it's not just what we have in our Bible. Not the prophets, that's what we believe.
So, but Jesus taught. Did Jesus teach this?
Absolutely. Yes. I know he's laughing. It's fine. Everyone has been talking about it. But they all laugh. This is what I believe.
That's why it's
the same way. My point is that I think the problem is that.
So let's come back to the point, right?
I don't want them laughing anything. I don't care about descendants. My point is.
No, I'm not talking about descendants. This is not a question about descendants.
Is this going to be an angel? As his angel from God.
Yes.
And we never say that.
No, I have understood your question.
Somebody is lying
about Gabriel, could be, right?
Yeah, could be.
Right.
I don't know who. So now, my point is that for me, now I know definitely we
understand. Okay, so you know how you said we came to London and start reading the Bible?
Yes.
Brother Mansour, he's been studying the Quran, I mean the Bible as well, for a long time. And he's
it doesn't matter. The Bible, when you read it with faith, the Holy Spirit will read it to you more. But
leave it, it's okay.
You can read it all day. Okay.
It will go away automatically.
If Christian scholars have written books and he reads those books and he learns from it, is that not the Christian perspective?
Even Catholics change the Bible. Of course, Orthodox change the Bible. Because they want to worship Mary, they have another book somewhere.
So then which one do you follow?
It doesn't matter. She follows what she has, right?
So that's this one.
So this is, brother, this is the precise reason I'm going to examine this.
I follow nobody else. I follow this book.
Yes.
Inspired by the word.
Okay, so if in this book he did show you mistake, why don't you read it?
We'd love to see it.
Okay, shall I show you?
Can I finish this and then you can?
But you already told me.
No, I haven't said anything yet. I haven't said anything, isn't it?
Show him.
Do you remember? Do you remember my point I'm making here?
Yes.
What is my point?
Your point is that when I'm asking you about Gabriel,
what is the reason I brought this up?
This is for you talking about descendants before Jesus. Or after.
But what is
Jesus.
My point quoting this?
You said that Matthew is wrong in here.
In what way?
You said to me that because this is not only 14th generation.
Right. So what if the generations numbers are different? And Matthew says 14.
To you, honestly, I'm not interested.
No. My question to you is simple. If Matthew says...
many topic.
No, please. Remember, an author who is a disciple is narrating information to you which you should take as gospel truth to save yourself from eternal damnation. If he says there are 14 generations, that means this is true, right? Must be true.
Mm-hmm. I don't know.
I mean, if he says 14...
He's talking about generation.
Please. If he says...
Is this important?
One second. Please.
This is not even...
If Matthew is describing something, whatever he's describing must be true, right? Or is he lying about it?
I'm not sure. Don't put words in my
okay.
mouth.
Do you think Matthew may be lying here and there?
No.
Good. So he must be...
Jesus teaching.
That's my point. So he must be speaking the truth all the time.
Yes.
So when he says 14...
Everything he copied what Jesus was teaching.
That's precisely the point I'm trying to make. If he says all the generations from Abraham to David are 14, he must be speaking the truth. Has to be.
So.
Right. But if we find...
But this is Matthew.
Well, sorry.
Why don't you...
Can I finish my point first? We are talking about how do we trust this book, which contains Gospel of Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and Acts of Apostles.
It is inspired by
Sure. So how do we?
You don't want to believe.
So how do we know a book is inspired from the Holy Spirit? We have to set up criteria. You may have one criteria, but we need to set up objective criteria that we can all agree on. Yeah. Otherwise, if you say, look, you have to have your Holy Spirit first to believe in it.
No. I'm not talking about
that. If somebody said that.
Jesus, don't get me wrong, brother. This is not my own word. Jesus said, unless you're born again, you will not be able to understand. He told the teacher, the leader of the Jews.
How do we...
Wait. The man didn't believe. He didn't understand. He thought Jesus was saying to him, oh, how am I going to come out of my mother womb now? I'm too old.
Mm-hmm.
But Jesus said to him, those that are born in flesh is flesh.
Right.
Those that are born in the spirit are spirit.
Okay.
Sometimes sometimes, brother, it's not easy. When we read it, as he said to me earlier, we can't just pick and choose what we want.
Yeah.
So that to prove your point, if we use it, the word of God like that, it's not nice.
So do you agree, in your criteria, someone has to be born of God to understand the scripture?
Jesus said to them, yes, you have to be born again.
But I don't believe I'm born of God. I don't believe in I'm born of God, because that's not my belief. So how do, as a non-Christian, authenticate and establish with certainty that this book is from God? I have to set up certain tests.
So there's no mistake. Basically, Jesus said,
as a non-Christian, I have to establish that this book demonstrates it's from God. That the author of this book have been honest throughout. I have to establish that to myself. Do you agree? Otherwise, I can believe in the Hindu books is from God.
No way. No.
If I do not have a set objective criteria to authenticate a scripture from God, I might believe in anything. Because we can't believe in anything.
But you Muslim pick up words from
No, forget them. Forget Muslim. Forget other people. Me, to establish that this is from God, I need to first make sure that it is so. Otherwise, I can believe in any book without making sure. Do you agree?
No, that's fine. Yeah.
But that's good. So the reason
I believe this is not true.
I know that you believe that.
To you today,
yeah, and that's how I'm
Allah, when I look at in the Quran,
that's how I'm answering.
The Bible, you're not answering.
I am answering by.
Don't worry about that.
No, I'm answering.
What I'm saying to you is, how can the Bible?
I have understood. I've understood.
Different God.
The way I'm answering is this: when you say Bible says this, you consider whatever is said is absolute truth. Now I, as a non-Christian, cannot take that for granted. You can, but I cannot. So that means I have to study this book.
God gave us free will, remember.
But do you agree then? As a non-Christian, I need to objectively, without any bias and bigotry, study this book and verify it.
Do you believe what Jesus said?
Yeah.
Do you believe what Jesus said?
No, please.
No, Jesus is your prophet.
Hear me out.
Say he's a prophet. Do you believe what he said?
Whatever Jesus said in reality, let's say Jesus said something. If this can be authenticated, then I will believe in it. The question is, how do we know?
I believe what Jesus said.
How do I know that what Jesus said?
I come to die for the sin of the world. So why don't you believe that?
My sister in humanity, the reason why I cannot believe what
Muhammad said.
No. Please listen. Allow me to express my own views.
That's fine, brother. I'm just saying.
What I'm saying is the reason I cannot accept what Jesus says in this book is because the person who wrote this book, in my estimation, is dishonest. And I was just giving you an example. He says there are 14 generations. We know, if you read 1 Chronicles chapter 3, verse 3 onwards.
That's fine. You don't need
okay,
to go there.
Fine. So,
okay, so
this is my first example,
are you
right?
Happy with that?
No. What I'm saying is, when I know that Matthew has distorted history by saying 14 when it was more than 14, and when I also know the people that he removed from these four generations, one of them was Jehoiakim. No, please. I'm gonna, instead of quoting three examples, I'll suffice with one, right? So I'll make this one as a, you know, complete example.
I wouldn't argue about the generation.
No, it's not about generations. It's not about generations.
The topic is that Jesus died on the cross for the humanity.
My sister, it's not about generation. It's about Matthew's honesty. So Matthew removes...
But because what he said here, so now you think that...
Allow me to just make my point first, right? This is my assessment, right? You can correct me in my assessment if I'm wrong. Good. That's what I'm giving you the opportunity. So I'm saying Matthew, he removes a name from there to make 14, but it's not just to make nice number 14 as a nice number.
We don't know. He wasn't there. Don't talk like that. Okay, we don't know why he does that.
If you allow me to... Look. If you allow me to make my point, you will see that it's not just...
I know your point.
Okay, tell me what I'm going to say.
Your point is that if he's wrong here, if you've got wrong generation here, I cannot trust what he said. But it's not what Matthew was here.
The detailed example about this is not about just generation. It's about a person he removes.
It doesn't matter.
Well, who is he named here? Who is it? Who was was it then?
Thank you.
Well, like, then said, wait,
that person.
I'm with you.
Right.
I agree with you.
That's fine. That,
the person.
I don't want to stay too long here.
If you, that's, yeah. I don't want to stay too long as well. But the
I don't want if you, to stay all evening.
If you allow me to finish the point quickly, then we can move on. Of course. Of course. I'd love to hear something from the Quran. So, he removes an individual called Jehoiakim. M at the end. Jehoiakim.
Jehoiakim, the king.
Yes, king of Judah. He removes this because God of the Old Testament curses Jehoiakim, the king of Judah, says, you and your descendants will have nothing to sit on the throne of David. If you consider what Matthew is trying to do, he's trying to make Jesus the son of David to sit on the throne of David. So if you have Jehoiakim in there, it's like shooting yourself on the foot. Because if Jesus came from the descendants of Jehoiakim, he cannot claim the throne of David. He cannot be the son of David. So he removes him altogether.
Why can't it be?
So, eh?
Why can't it be?
Because God cursed Jehoiakim and his descendants. That no one from him or his descendants can be claiming to be...
Where does it say that?
Jeremiah 36:30.
I agree with that,
here.
Honestly.
No. He may have his
hang
son.
On. Wait.
His son, but not the whole descendants, no. His son, maybe.
No. Let's read what he has to say.
The Bible is truth, mate. I mean,
here.
It's only truth.
Do you want to... One moment, brothers. No arguments before I come to the lady. We'll finish this. Just want to show this and then I'll come back to you, God willing. Now,
we're going to stay here today.
Shall I read? Shall we? Shall we read it together? Jeremiah chapter 36, verse 30. Therefore, thus says the Lord concerning Jehoiakim, king of Judah, he shall have no one to sit on the throne of David, and his dead body shall be cast out the heat of the day and the frost of the night. I will punish him, his family, and his servants for the iniquity. And I will bring on them, on the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and on the men of Judah, all the doom that I have pronounced against them. But they did not heed. So this is not just
Jehoiakim. Maybe brother took the next.
No.
Brother took it, didn't he?
It's all. Everyone. This is, look, this is, yeah, I'm coming now. You can have your Bible. So it's very clear. Matthew, in my estimation, is dishonest. That's why we can't believe anything.
That's okay, brother.
Yeah.
It's fine.
That's fine.
We respect each other.
Right. Let's hear what your objections.
In Muhammad, I have a question.
Yep.
My first question, you didn't answer it.
Which was?
That's fine. We're not going to go back there. But my second question now, if Muhammad claims that he received all the scriptures from Gabriel angel, why is he Muhammad then he was reciting from Satan? And he didn't even know until Allah came.
So when you say, so again, remember, you are saying Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam recited from Satan.
Yeah.
How come I don't know that as a Muslim? Did you know that he recited from Satan? Did you? Is there any Muslims who knows that Prophet Muhammad recited from Satan?
I'll show you.
Okay. So how come you know something that we don't?
Did say that he recited from Satan.
Where did this come from?
Okay, let's see. Where is the source of your information?
I saw it. I found it.
Okay.
I've got a lot of proof. I'm not speaking without proof. You know that.
No, but which book did you get it from? These notes, which books did you get it from?
Some of it is from Hadar.
Your religion is only came, when did it come out? 650, wasn't it?
From the time of Adam, how long is that?
No, that was God.
That's
the Bible.
No.
The Bible came from Adam.
Never
Adam.
Remember,
right?
He's our prophet.
After Jesus.
No.
Muhammad.
No. You want to care about, when did he come about? Your religion started 650 BC or whatever?
The religion is the same religion throughout.
No. I was the same. It started with Ethiopia.
Was David a prophet?
Yeah, man, you only came out.
What's the
common teaching? You only came 650 BC.
So we've just heard David is not a prophet.
Right, because you have all the same prophets, isn't it? Listen, our Bible has been going for 8,000 years, 7,000 years.
Huh?
7,000 years the Bible has been going. Sorry.
What,
Adam
the
and
New
Eve.
Testament?
Eh?
The New Testament.
The whole of it. From the beginning, right, it started from Adam 7,000 years ago. the Bible. You lot only came about 650 BC.
Did Adam?
You have
this is a book from Adam time.
Okay.
Is this a book from Adam time?
Yes. You should know that. He's died in, yeah. Adam.
Well, this is speaker's corner for you.
Adam.
Yeah. Is this the one when Muhammad was
converted? He started from 7,000 years ago, right?
Okay. So you tell me exactly where you have read this, because remember we are authenticating narrations.
1922.
In Surah 53, Surah An-Najm doesn't say anything. The Prophet is speaking from Satan. But where do you get this information that he was speaking from the words of Satan?
This is from Sahih Bukhari.
Sahih Bukhari doesn't say anything like that. Do you have the quote? Where is the quote? Okay. So does it say he speaks? He spoke the Quran from the Satan?
No.
So can you find? No. Can you find where he received anything from the Satan as a revelation?
Are you saying that in the Quran right now we have something that from Satan?
Which verse?
No. Muhammad says that when the sight from Satan, but he didn't realize that Allah can abolish them.
Where does he say that?
It's in your Quran.
It's not. But please bring it next time, please.
And then after that, Muhammad ibn Ashia said he was bewitched.
The claim is quite specific. You said the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam received revelation from Satan.
It says here.
What does he say?
Well, read it. My handwriting is, you can read it.
No, I can't read. Your handwriting is very neat. But where is this from?
This is from the.
No. Remember.
Quran. Yes. From
the event. Sahih Bukhari, okay. What exactly in which Sahih Bukhari book?
Sahih Bukhari, you don't believe guys or hadith?
No,
please.
You know Sahih Bukhari is...
I accept Sahih Bukhari, right? Sahih Bukhari, what's the reference? Where can I find that what you're saying? Because I know for sure it doesn't say that in Sahih Bukhari. I'm certain of that. In Surah An-Najm it doesn't say that either. I'm absolutely 100% positive.
So can I see you next week Sunday?
Yes, please. So we'd like to hear next week where the Prophet himself says that he received revelation from Satan.
Yes, he does.
Yep.
Revelation. He does.
Then, yeah, huh? Because then, yep. What you will discover when you go back home.
But then he also had magic. Something has the bond to him, Muhammad. So if he's
look
for me, my question.
The Quran is very clear. God is in charge of revelation. So even if the Prophet was bewitched or magic,
no.
Nothing to do with revelation.
No. Listen, it says Muhammad definitely says in his own mouth that he recites from Satan, Alusa, and Anath, and Manat. So he realized then, he didn't realize, but then Allah abolished them. It's definitely there. I'm going to bring it.
Okay, just one question.
Definitely. And another thing, wait.
Okay.
And then Muhammad was, sorry, I keep touching him, I'm so sorry. Another thing is that Muhammad was bewitched, he was possessed by demons.
No,
and magic, whatever. So Allah said somewhere else that.
Was he possessed by demon? Well, he had the action of magic,
whatever,
which affected him.
If it's magic, Allah said in the Quran, no one, he said to Satan, I have no authority over my servants, over my slaves, unless they have wrong evil in their heart or they follow.
Authority to do what?
Or they follow.
Authority to do what?
So if Muhammad is a true prophet from God, how did he, Satan, has to put this word in his mouth?
And as I said, Satan did not. If you're just going back and forth on the same subject, so let me respond to both of these points. Let me respond on another point. Third, do you know something, my sister in humanity? Why do I think all your information did not come from individual sincere research, but they all come from? Can I make my point? Why do I suspect that your information that you're bringing up is not from your own personal research? They are guided by reading and researching your own Christian polemics or atheist websites or some things like this. Honestly, I mean, I don't want to put you on the spot by asking this question, which I will not, because it's not fair that I do that. Right. So you can ask. I am affirming with absolute certainty in the Quran and the authentic hadith, like the Bukhari, you said, there is no such thing as the Prophet saying he received inspirations or words of God or revelation from Satan. Nothing. Absolutely nothing.
But if I come to you with the Quran
in the Quran, then nothing.
Nothing.
What do you find? Look, we have many memorizers of the Quran. Even in the park.
You know how many Quran do you have today? Because
I know where now your information is from. Now you, I'm confirming layer upon layer of confirmation. Look,
just help me.
Let me tell you. Let me tell you the answer. There is one Quran that can be recited. If you allow me to finish my point, there is one Quran. That Quran can be recited as the Prophet recited in several ways. Right. So fact of the matter. Is the Quran is the same. If I were to bring you manuscripts of the Quran, which the early manuscripts without any dots and diacritical points, you can recite the same Quran in different ways that we recite today from the same Quran. It doesn't mean it's different. 2, 3, 4, 5, 7, 36, are you saying? It's the same one Quran. The God in his mercy, he gave this dispensation to allow different Arabian tribes to understand the message of the Quran. And Prophet ﷺ, from the divine sanction, allowed them to recite the Quran as he taught them. Sometimes he allowed them from divine sanction to recite a word with a synonym. We know that. Because a particular tribe, maybe that they cannot understand this word in their own dialect. And he allowed them from, again, teaching from God through Angel Gabriel. This is why you can shout. So this is what is known as Ahraf of the Quran, from which...
Problem, though, brother.
Why is that a problem?
My problem is that
God showing mercy, and you're saying it's a problem.
My problem that I find it really hard. For me, as you human being like me, and special Muslim, I know them very well. Before I meet you here, I was Muslim. My brother, sister, we don't have no problem. We never even done this. But from my point is that, what the reason I want to search is not that I want to find the wrong in the Quran. I don't know. I wasn't there.
Are you searching in the right way?
The reason is no. The reason I'm searching is not that I want to, I'm looking for the truth so that I can be a Muslim. It's not that. I have the truth here. I have the truth, the way, everything in my hand. But I want to know if we're serving the same God.
Yeah.
But from what I have, especially the two topics, the very, very important topic, Jesus is the Son of God, he's divine human, and then he died on the cross. I didn't find them in the Quran. So now, for me, one second, now for me, you must understand, honestly, for me, so nice of me even for me to do that, brother, because I want to know.
I have several questions on this very same thing.
So what I'm saying is that, clearly,
they're different.
Allah is not my God.
No. Certainly, no, the Quran clearly says, look, brother, one second. You're absolutely right. The Quran, you are absolutely right in the sense that the Quran goes against,
look,
the Quran goes against many teachings in your Bible. It says Jesus is not God.
The Quran says that Allah hasn't got no begotten son.
Yep.
He also said about crucifixion, which is Jesus himself said that I would be dying for 3 days, I would be sacrificed, and I would be raised again. So now, the Quran says about that, in Boston they said we killed Jesus Christ, but they didn't kill him.
Absolutely.
So it appeared to them like, you know, like Allah, like make it appear to them like...
It appeared to them that, right. Yeah, it appeared to them.
So God will deceive like that anyway.
It's not about deception.
I don't believe that, but...
Sorry, just one second. When you say deception, again, so I keep finding confirmation layers that your information is actually, I'm sorry to say that, if it offends you, please forgive me, right? What I'm saying is this, your research, the way you're approaching your research, but the way you approach in your investigation and examination seems to me quite unfair. Because you are coming up with the objections and criticisms of the Islamophobes.
I don't want to criticize them.
No.
My point is
the way you come with these criticisms.
Even if I come from that, you know, there's a scholars, they talk about Muslim, they say,
do you okay?
Muhammad did this. I'm not like
if I were to no, if I were
like
to
that.
Okay.
I came from
okay.
Africa.
Hear me.
Get married young woman.
Sure.
Isn't it in Eritrea? Young girls
yeah.
Get married. I remember my
but hear me out though. Hear me out. I could, if I wanted to, show you how the biblical God is a deceiver from the statements of Paul or from other writers. Trust me, I'm here since the 90s doing that.
I'm gonna pray that.
No, please.
It's up to you. No, you're free. You're
no, no, no. If you allow me to finish my point, look. If you allow me to finish my point.
He's understood the Bible. That's what it is.
What I am saying.
Brother, he's gonna stand before God one day.
Exactly. Yeah.
At least, try to understand my point.
See,
I don't understand.
I could equally make a claim.
Yeah.
Let's consider it as a claim, right? I could equally make a claim that the biblical God is a deceiver, and we'd have a discussion about this, right? But I'm not going to do that. But you have been consistently making claims which I know is not a product of independent, sincere research. But given that anyway, whatever your approach is, still, the things that you want to compare, remember, you want to make this as a standards of truth. I cannot accept this. And I've given my reasons. Because to accept something to be true has to come from a true source, from an individual who is truthful. So I gave you an example, which you can think about it later. I could have given you more. Likewise, when you say like Jesus is the Son of God and that, if you think about it, every single theological belief within Christianity, if you were to use reason, remember, not emotion, reason. God didn't just give us emotion only, did he? Do you agree? Do you agree God also gave us reason?
Absolutely.
Right.
God gave us free will.
If we use our reason, you would realize that the God who is absolute, all knowledgeable, cannot become other than what he is.
Oh, you limited him. You put him in the box.
Exactly.
God can do anything.
No,
my brother.
One second.
You're not God. God is up there.
Right.
He can do anything.
God does what he wants.
Do you sincerely believe that?
He does what he wants.
Okay. Can I? Right. So, just one second.
God
you
makes a plan.
Just said God can do anything.
That's why he's called God.
Remember, that's what the problem
is. He makes the rules.
Wait. The problem is you put God in the box.
Can I give you an example? Can I give you an example?
No, God put you in the box.
No. Can I give you an example and you can affirm whether God can do that?
Yeah, I wouldn't believe it.
No.
Because you're limited. You're talking about God.
Please. Allow me to.
Sure.
You said.
No.
Remember.
Everyone's gonna judge by the words. They're gonna judge.
Remember.
No, you can't say anything. But look. Don't call his name.
Look.
God doesn't decide.
Look. I said. No. I said.
You said it, don't you? You said the Bible.
Perhaps. You know what?
Answer me. You said.
Can I say what I said?
My darling. You said.
Can I say what I said?
No. You said. No. Correct me if I'm wrong. But you did say the Bible, the God of the Bible says the same.
You're wrong. Let me tell you what I said.
You did.
I am just saying I didn't. Let me tell you what I said. I said I can equally make a claim and show you from the statements of Paul or other writers where God is a deceiver. That's what I said.
God is a deceiver. Which God is a deceiver?
Oh, please. I said I can make a claim by looking and reading the Bible, statements from it. Good. So at least I'm not saying that God is a deceiver. So now my point again. The reason what I'm saying is to use the reason. Can I make a point, please?
No. Before you go anywhere, I'm not going to stand here listening to you disagree with the word of God. But what I can tell you is my point is, brother, I respect you so much. Now I know 100,000,000% Allah, the God of the Bible, are not the same. So you need to find out
how
Allah is.
Sure.
This is the God of the God.
That's
of
your opinion. That's your opinion.
The God of Abraham, Isaac, and
no, Israel, look.
The God of Jesus Christ.
Fine.
This is our God. Come to Jesus. Repent right. Your sin. Turn away. Born again. You will see Him
okay.
One day in heaven.
Fine. So
now
allow.
Finish here.
No. Hang on. This is not fair. This is not fair.
No.
It's not fair.
Answer. It's not the Son of God.
Are you using your reason or emotion at now?
I don't. No.
Are you being emotional?
Brother, I give you chance.
Are you being emotional? It's not you giving me chance. We were giving each other opportunities to express ourselves. Right. So final point from me. No, final point from me then. No. Final point from me, right?
What I'm saying to you.
Would you allow me to make my final point?
We disagree.
But we could disagree.
But we disagree.
One thing you said.
We don't serve the same.
Look, it is not fair on me that that I just speak to the camera and to the people or someone else.
Okay.
No, no.
I said to the camera, we said from God. God is in heaven, who created heaven and earth. He said himself to Moses, I'm the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. And he said, Jesus is my son, my beloved son, listen to him. He gave him authority in Matthew 28 to literally over heaven and earth. So basically, this is what I believe. He kind of blamed me. So I know that this is the truth.
No one is taking the belief away from you. Right. Yeah, but I want to make the statement that you said earlier.
Everything you said is a lie.
Please.
No, you don't know the Bible.
Look, I'm not talking about the Bible now.
You're looking all day to find it wrong. Anything. That's not faith.
Is this how you took my statements?
In fact, I doubt the Quran. You know why?
Wait. Before you doubt.
You didn't receive from angel. I was dreaming. I shall have to tell him. Oh no, it's a Gabriel angel. It's not a demon. He ran to his wife. I saw a demon. I was shaking in the cave. So remember, you need to examine the Quran. You need to know that. You need the truth. You need.
How would you examine it? Would you examine with a sincere heart or a blind heart?
No, you.
Oh. Would you examine the Quran with a sincere heart or with a blind heart?
With a sincere heart.
Thank you. So now, returning. Very good. I agree with you. Now, returning to the question that you had, you said, God can do anything. Do you really believe in that?
Absolutely.
Okay. Can God cease to exist?
No. What I'm saying to you.
Do you believe God can do anything?
She has spoken already.
No, I'm asking you because you are together. Can God cease to exist? Can God cease to exist?
So God is eternal.
He's confused. Yeah. He doesn't.
Your friend said God can do anything.
You need to come to
ceasing to exist is part of this.
Don't miss the thing. God cannot tell lies.
So God cannot do everything.
No.
God cannot.
Thank you. Thank you. You disagree with her. Your friend said God cannot do everything. Your friend just said God cannot do this, cannot do that. Okay. So now you realize God. Now you realize. We were having a good discussion. Suddenly, you become emotional for some reason.
No. I read the Quran and what I read.
No.
Quran, it was shocking.
After all this discussion, suddenly you have become very emotional.
Doesn't even like a woman.
Why? What's triggering her?
He said to the husband,
is it you?
She
no. What triggered her to become suddenly emotional? She was having a very good discussion. But why has she become emotional?
She's not emotional.
Is she not? She's become emotional now. Look, I am simply saying, when you examine this book of the Bible, so I found it, thank you. I know the truth of the Bible, it's not from God. You're absolutely right. I examined it and I found it's not from God.
Several authors over thousands of years.
They are not coherent. Remember what you said, they are coherent. Ezekiel chapter 18 disagrees with everything else.
She has spoken to you already.
On Ezekiel? She hasn't spoken to me on Ezekiel.
No,
she says it's finished. That's why I'm speaking to you. You're a Christian, aren't you? Right. Do you believe God died for you?
I have already spoken to your people there, and I'm tired now.
Oh, you're tired?
Yes.
That's fine. That's fine. Take some rest. Next time, if I see you, maybe we can discuss.
Yes.
When you're not tired, come with a cup of coffee or tea, whatever.
Sure.
Very refreshing, because the discussion we may have may be very tiring for you. Yeah. So, God willing, get some refreshment
by
first.
By that time, I pray that you will know the truth.
I know the truth already. It has done it already. It has done it already. I know the truth. I know God doesn't die. You believe God dies?
I have already spoken that point.
Yeah, but it's true though. You believe God dies?
Why have you changed from God elephant to God man?
How do you know she was a Hindu? And how do you know?
She looked like.
No. You can't assume from people. You can't assume.
She used to.
No. You can't assume. You can ask her what she previously believed.
Elephant. She knows she has a God man.
You can't assume. him, brother. It's not. You can't assume.
I'm a Christian.
You are Christian.
Were you a Hindu before?
Never. We're Indian.
I swear.
Understand.
Be sincere now. We're talking honestly.
Were you a Hindu before? He's asking.
No. Say? I was never a Hindu.
But you're Sri Lankan.
I'm an Indian.
India.
So, do you see what I mean? Don't assume people and judge people based on where they come from. But doesn't matter. She has given her own word.
Yes.
You know what? She was not a Hindu. Yeah. So this is one lesson for all of us, right? Do not judge people because from their which nation, states, or community they come from, right? You could have been born Christian for generations. It's possible, isn't it? Yeah. Okay. But anyway, because you're tired, we will not discuss. But when you're not tired in the weeks to come, maybe we can discuss the very idea of God dying, because I find that very repulsive. No, you spoke to my brother Hashim.
Yeah. His name is Hashim.
God created this human nature, or he had this human nature from before?
You can keep talking.
Okay, it's difficult. I know. While you're tired, these questions are very difficult. When you're refreshed, we can talk about it. Okay,
like he said, he says in the Quran, it appears to be.
Okay, anyway. We'll finish here.
We finish.
Yeah, okay, thank you. Perhaps we can talk about not emotional.
I'm not emotional, brother. I'm just saying to you, you must respect. This is for me.
I know.
I believe.
This is a passion. Okay.
It's not passion. It's the truth.
So but it felt like you're emotional.
You know when you say it's the truth. If someone shows you that there is a mistake in the Bible,
it's not a mistake. Jesus is still, the whole world knows Jesus died on the cross. Only Islam denied that, and that's Antichrist.
Do you know the Christians didn't believe, many Christians didn't believe Jesus died on the cross? But you said the whole world except Muslims.
People know that like he died on the cross celebration.
But there were Christians who did not believe Jesus Christ died on the cross.
They're not Christian. There is no
that's
way.
That's your way of, you know, maybe they consider you not a Christian. See? Anyway, take care. Take care, and perhaps we talk again, right? Thank you. Take care.
In a spring of murky water.